this edition of Art Loft. Meet a Haitian composer marching to the beat of an experimental drum.
It should be fun. Performing arts are sometimes relegated to something that's kind of cerebral.
Sculpture meets science with shattering results. Classical music in a contemporary environment.
New World Symphony really encourages musicians to explore different ways of engaging the audience.
And a Miami author champions civil rights and channels teenage angst.
There was probably a story that these older women had to tell this other generation of young women.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation, the Miami-Dade County Tourist Development Council, the Miami-Dade County Department of Cultural Affairs and the Cultural Affairs Council, the Miami-Dade County Mayor, and the Board of County Commissioners. And
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kalyn, and from the Guerra de la Paz exhibit at the Center for Visual Communication in Wynwood, this is Art Loft. Hi, everyone. This week, we reflect on historic human rights violations, fling some crockery, and make beautiful music. But first up, we're going to the park, where the composer Daniel Bernard Romain's site-specific event, En Masse, recently invited picnickers to become part of the performance. Take a look.
One.
I'm an American composer. I'm a Haitian American composer. But I think today, black composer works. Because I'm doing black classical music. I'm using drum kits. I'm using a composer's response to rock and hip hop and Haitian music. I'm using things that are, in its roots, something that speaks to R&B and soul and rock music. I'm not doing Eastern European classical music. Both of my parents are from Haiti. Haitian music is very melodic and very percussive. You know, it really is a marriage between things that are very tonal and beautiful in that sense and things that are very angular and percussive. And they come together. I live in Harlem on 135th Street and 5th Avenue. Right now, there are men on that corner drinking, hanging out, talking about the world. They're not using the King's English, but they're talking about the world. And if you want to talk with them, you have to be able to speak their language, slang. Right now, at the University of Houston, there are similar conversations going on, probably using the King's English, you know? I want to participate in both of those conversations and then write a piece about it. I think that as a black composer, it is actually my responsibility and obligation to seek out those voices that are not necessarily seen or heard and put them on the stage right next to me. As my good Haitian mother would often remind me, yeah, somebody gave you a spotlight, but can you spread that spotlight out and let it shine on others? So the first project we're about to embark on is a piece called En Masse, Studies and Etudes. En Masse is a fragmentation, a defragmentation actually, of a marching band experience. It's 4 hours long. It will involve hundreds of musicians from the University of Houston's marching band. See and hear hundreds of musicians in their uniform, almost like an installation, throughout the park, playing my music. It'll be at times loud and fast. And other times it'll be slow and meditative. The audience is supposed to wander and promenade throughout the space and hear and see these very talented musicians. Yeah. It's fully interactive. It's a way to look at specifically a marching band from a completely new and different perspective.
You know, the audience is really figuring it out for themselves, and the band is too. The band is too. There's a wonderful evaporation of the fourth wall. You know, the musicians and the audience are literally talking and sharing and exploring music.
Be fun. Performing arts are sometimes relegated to something that's kind of cerebral and thick and dense and heavy. That's not what this piece is about. This is something that is good and good-natured, and you know, it's for adults as much as it's for children. You know, and I have a young son, and I'm oftentimes trying to see the world through his eyes, which everything is magical, everything is full of wonder. So that's what this piece is about. It speaks to the world, not as it is, but as it should be. And that we all have a voice and that it should be heard.
DBR, as Daniel is known, is an artist in residence at the University of Houston's Mitchell Center for the Arts, which commissioned this piece. Find out more at mitchellcenterforarts.org.
So, what we have back here is another painting. I actually like the paintings on the back better than the front.
Our next story also finds music in an unusual place. If you listen closely amidst the pumping beats from dance clubs on South Beach, you can hear the sounds of classical greats such as Chopin, Mozart, and Bach, to name a few. Once a month, New World Symphony Fellows come together for impromptu performances. Next stop is the Art Center of South Florida. Let's listen in.
Art Center South Florida is a contemporary visual art center, and we have here almost 40 artists in residence where they work in their studios, and we have a whole programming of exhibition series and public programs and outreach programs and educational programs, and we are partnering with many other organizations here in Miami. We think that collaboration and partnerships are a must between cultural organizations, and we are really, really happy and proud to have the New World Symphony here at the Art Center, such an amazing organization with a very, very talented and bright musicians, and it's a pleasure having them here playing once a month. It's an opportunity of listening to classical music in a very different environment, and I think that it enhances a cultural experience. The audience have the chance to listen to chamber music in an environment with contemporary visual art, and they have also the chance to get in and out and wandering around their center, meet the artists, talk to them, talk to the musicians. I think that is a very, very fresh project program.
The New World Symphony really encourages musicians to explore different ways of engaging the audience and the communities they live in. So we have a number of different concert formats that allow the musicians to explore their own ideas inside the concert hall, and it also provides them inspiration to bring those ideas out in the community, just like you see here tonight.
The name Impromptu sort of stuck out as representing this spontaneous nature, almost maybe more for the audience than for us, because the concerts are planned in advance, but the audience doesn't know they're going to see a concert until they walk by most of the time. So that's the impromptu part of the series.
We have the people who are just walking by, and they look in through the window and they're like, what's going on? And they come in, and even if they only stay for 15 minutes, it makes me happy because it's like an unplanned gift that we gave to them. Mm-hmm. And they didn't know that day that they were gonna go out and see a string quartet playing.
Arrive here to the art center, and they have the chance to listen to this amazing music and see visual art. It's important to find any way to expose the public and the audience to a cultural experience, whether it's music, whether it's theater, it's visual arts. I think that finding new ways and different ways to expose the public to these experiences is really important.
The kids can come right up and sit right in front of us. We've had kids come and sit down, you know, like a foot away from our instruments, and they're just so fascinated getting to see the music making up close rather than having some kind of barrier like a stage and an audience. It's really touching to see how emotionally they respond. They start dancing and singing, and these are all things that would be inappropriate in a concert setting, but if it's their natural response, then this is a great way to let that out, and instead of stifling it, I think it should be encouraged.
Not having a clear program, we kind of walk in here with a bag of music and we look around and see who showed up and what we can do.
Dealing with kind of the crash and burn situations where if we're playing a difficult piece that none of us has ever played together before and maybe it falls apart and you got the audience right here in front of you, and it's like, how do you recover? And we're just shouting out measure numbers and people are all over the place. But I think as embarrassing as that can be sometimes, it definitely puts everything on a more human level for the audience too, and it doesn't need to be perfect in this setting. That's not the goal, and it's probably more fun to see that it's a process. Music making is a process. It's not just doesn't just happen.
I think this venue is so great because the windows just catch so much attention from the people passing by, and a really relaxed environment. People get inspired to come in, and it's always kind of surprising to me to see the types of people that sit through an entire chamber music work, because often in a concert you get fidgety, you get tired, but in this environment where it's very relaxed, the musicians are wearing street clothes, if you will. They can just sit and take it in, and it's really surprising the types of people that seem to enjoy it.
When you actually get people to come in off the street, it means that you're grabbing them in a very powerful way, and you get that instant feedback of whether what you're doing is creating a response. And the longer people stay, you can tell how interested they are and that you're really connecting.
By logging on to artcentersf.org or New World Symphony at nws.edu.
Some of the young activists that I had met, some of the Filipinas who are on the streets, and I was able to write, even during all those hurricanes happening and threatening and that kind of thing, a story about the comfort women.
Robert Chambers describes his work as an experimentation of material and tool with contemporary narrative response. The team from Wet Heat TV spent a day with Chambers in his studio and explored his unique approach to his work. You may want to grab some protective eyewear.
Thank you.
The calibration is all off today, so everything is flying. I think I hit one of your lights over here. This one's done, but I think I'm gonna use it to hang, I'm gonna hang a, and do a small painting, which I'm gonna send off to this show in Basel today. So I'm gonna hang that there, and hopefully I'll get one that's gonna make it over there. Okay. This one came out really nice. I just like really what happens in here. So what we have back here is another painting. I actually like the paintings on the back better than the front. Here is more about the surface. Here. Why I do what I do? Well, I've just been continually trying to just make work and continue without being reined in or controlled by any one thing, which sometimes can have some consequences. Teaching. I like teaching. Am I sweating too much? No. I became an Argentine barbecue with the lights.
For more on Robert Chambers, visit his website at robertchambers.com. And for more artist profiles in the Studio Drive-By series, visit wetheat.tv, where you can even find past segments that appeared right here on Art Loft.
And it's an incredible documentation of how quickly things changed.
Our final story tonight features Miami author M. Evelina Galang. Her latest novel, Angel de la Luna and the Fifth Glorious Mystery, is the coming-of-age story of a young Filipina struggling with loss and healing, set against the backdrop of historic human rights violations. Here is her story.
My name is M. Evelina Galang, and I direct the creative writing program at the University of Miami, and I write fiction. I have a collection of short stories called Her Wild American Self, a novel called One Tribe, and most recently, the book that is coming out this fall is Angel de la Luna and the Fifth Glorious Mystery. I have been researching the lives of surviving Filipina comfort women since about 1998, and I've had, I think, the great good fortune to meet about 40 of the women, and I've been documenting 15 of their stories, 15 of the women's stories. I went back to the Philippines on a number of occasions, and I have about 30 hours of videotape, so I have sat where you're sitting, and heard their testimonies, and not only that, but have gone to their sites of abduction and to these garrisons where they were held during World War II. So the subject matter, the heart of the book that I was trying to write, or that I have written since this book, is about the comfort women, and it's a book that documents their stories. You know, writing their stories is a lot different, their testimonies is a lot different than writing fiction, because there is a weight of wanting to be accurate and of wanting to be true, of wanting to get the right story out there. And so I've actually talked to them on different occasions and had them repeat the story to me and take me to different parts of that story and at different times to make sure it's correct. At the same time, the women are dying, and they're probably in their 80s, late 80s, mid-90s now, and many of them have passed away. Several of the women that I've talked to have passed away. So yeah, there is the pressure to get their stories out. There's something that happens when you meet the survivors, and when I met the survivors, I'll talk about my experience. I met them back in 1998, and they were not just subjects for a story. They really became friends, and they really became grandmothers, and their stories cut to my bone. I could not sit still. I could not keep quiet. I felt a commitment to their plight, which is they have been seeking a formal apology from Japan, and they've been wanting reparations, and they've been wanting these stories to be documented in history. And we see, as you probably have seen, that Japan is resistant. And not only are they resistant, but they're in the process of trying to erase that history from world history. Actually, this particular book, Angel de la Luna, started out as we were talking about the 15 women's stories, and I was writing during the year that Hurricane Katrina hit. I don't know if you remember that year, but it was Katrina, and it was Rita, and it was Wilma. All of them were happening at once, and I was living at Hecht Residential College as a faculty master with the promise of writing these women's stories. Well, those hurricanes made it impossible to give it the kind of attention I needed, and yet I needed to write. What came out was this novel, this story that was based on some of the women that I had met, some of the young activists that I had met, some of the Filipinas who were on the streets, and I was able to write, even during all those hurricanes happening and threatening and that kind of thing, a story about the comfort women. So I found that there was probably a story that these older women had to tell this other generation of young women, and that there was probably a lesson to be learned. So I think that's where the give and take of the stories have been, you know, between the contemporary young Filipina American and the comfort women of World War II. One of the things that all teenagers don't want to do is be told who they are and where to live and who to be. And I can pretty much guarantee they don't want to be given a dream. They want to have their own dreams. So there's something very universal in the way Angel is living her life and in conflict with her mother. It's very universal. And the other thing is, I had heard a couple stories of young immigrants who had said they never had any desire to come to the United States, but these are choices their parents made, and they were choices their parents made for their benefit. And I thought that was interesting. Here, all these people are looking at the United States as the land of opportunity and the place of the American dream, and you've got youth who are connected to these parents, right, who are only looking for the best for their kids, and they're resistant, which is actually incredibly natural, right? I'm very grateful for where I'm at, and I'm very grateful for my community, and I think there are so many different kinds of stories. So rather than feeling guilty or wanting a different experience, I feel like I feel really blessed to have people open up and share with me these different aspects of what it means to be an immigrant or what it means to be Filipino-American. You know what I'm saying?
Ms. Kalyn will be a guest at this year's Miami Book Fair International, which is celebrating its 30th anniversary. If you'd like to learn more about Ms. Kalyn and her other works, visit her website at mevelinagalyn.com. And you can find out more about this year's Miami Book Fair International by visiting them online at miamibookfair.com. And that wraps it up for this edition of Art Loft. For more arts and culture, visit wpbt2.org/artloft, where you'll find featured videos, blogs, and information on upcoming arts events. And you can also watch older episodes of Art Loft. And be sure to look for us on Facebook and Twitter at ArtLoftSFL. Until next week, I'm Kalyn James, reminding you to stay creative. Thanks for watching. Artist in residence at University. first one is okay or no?
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation, the Miami-Dade County Tourist Development Council, the Miami-Dade County Department of Cultural Affairs and the Cultural Affairs Council, the Miami-Dade County Mayor, and the Board of County Commissioners, and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.